Okay, good one to wonder. Yeah, let's try to have a discussion about what you discussed in yesterday's class. Okay, 1 minute. Okay, yes, why we need transforms? Let's try to recollect this one. Why required Fourier transform, Fourier series, and such things? What can be the purpose of them? Yeah, one of you can answer. Let's consider linear time invariant system with impulse response h of t. Then what is the concerned output y of t? Yes, what is the output?
X of t convolution h of t.
Okay, x of t linear convolution with h of t, right? This includes, yeah, integration. A bit complicated, right? This integration. And when coming to transform domain, if this is x of f and if this is h of f, then y of f is simply multiplication of x of f and h of f, right? It's a bit easier as compared to doing this one. After that, you can go for inverse transform of y of f to get back to your y of t. It's one way. That's another benefit we are going to get, right? Let's have a look into that example once again. Let's consider ideal low pass filter with cutoff frequency fc equals to n kilohertz. For example, input to this filter is, yeah, let me try to sketch this one. This is frequency versus gain or frequency response of the system, h of f. Let me consider ideal, minus 10 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz, and the gain is 1, and the gain in the stop band is 0. The ideal low pass filter, and phase of this one is 0. And what will be the concerned impulse response of the system, h of t? Yes. What is the
sync function, sir?
Sync function, right? We are going to get sync function. This will be my h of t, impulse response of this system. Suppose my input x of t to this system is cos 2 pi f1 t plus cos 2 pi f2 t, where f1 equals to 1 kilohertz and f2 equals to 12 kilohertz, then what will be the my concerned output y of t? You can apply any one of them. This is an LTA system with impulse response h of t as impulse. If that is x of t, output will be h of t convolution with x of t. Otherwise, in the frequency domain, that is multiplication, right? You can try to apply any one of them. Which one might be easy for you? Is it easy to do convolution of this signal with sync pulse? Is it easy or difficult?
obviously difficult, sir.
It's very difficult, right? That's the reason we are trying to approach for this one, transform domain. In this transform domain, if you try to apply this trick, that multiplication in the frequency domain, then what will be this output? When cos 2 pi f1 t is the input to this system, where f1 equals to 1 kilohertz, then what is the output?
Cos 2 pi f1 t, sir.
Once again, cos 2 pi f1 t, right? Same as cos 2 pi f1 t. Plus, because the reason is the gain at frequency 1 kilohertz is 1, gain of this system. And phase introduced by this one also 0, zero phase system. Because I cannot mention any phase for this, right? This is just 1. H of f equal to 1 at 1 kilohertz. It means I am going to get 1 into that particular thing, right? The gain. There is no phase added to this one. Then what about this second term? If this is input to this system, where f2 equals 12 kilohertz, then what is the output of this?
0, sir.
0, right? 0 into this one. That's same as 0. We are going to get plus 0. Then this is the final output we are going to get. That's the benefit of using transforms. And let me try to explain with some other tricks. Suppose x plus jy and a plus jb. R2 e power j theta 2. What is this coordinate system? This first one.
Cartesian
or rectangle, right? Rectangular coordinate system or Cartesian coordinate system. Then what about this?
Polar form.
See, polar coordinate system, right? Yeah, which one will be easier to add? I want to add x plus jy can be expressed like this. A plus jb can be expressed like this. This is an equivalent form. For example, r2 equal to root a square plus b square and theta 2 equals to tan inverse b by a, right? And in this case, r1 equals to root x square plus y square and theta 1 equals to tan inverse y by x. Similarly for this one, you can have that. Which one you feel easy? I want to add this one and this one. Or I want to add this one and this one. Which one is easy?
Rectangular is easy, sir.
Okay, rectangular is easy, right? You can simply add real parts and you can simply add imaginary parts. If you add these two things, x plus a plus j into y plus b. What about multiplication? When coming polar to multiplication, form, polar form is easy, right? Because you can simply multiply these two things, r1, r2, and you can add phases. E power j into theta 1 plus theta 2. If you try to multiply this one and this one, you may require how many multiplications? Real multiplications. You may require 4, right, total. X into a minus y into b plus j into x into b plus y into a. You require total 4 multiplications, 4 real multiplications. But here you require only 2 real multiplications, right? When coming to polar coordinate system. It means, see, some of the operations might be easy in polar coordinate system. And some operations might be easy in Cartesian coordinate system. You can't say always polar is good, or you can't say always rectangular is good, right? When coming to additions and subtractions, that rectangular coordinate system is a bit easier. When coming to multiplications or divisions, polar coordinate system will be easier for you, right? And one more thing, you might study something. Have you covered electromagnetic theory? Is this course covered for you in last semester? Is it covered?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's fine. In this course, you might be studying about rectangular coordinate system. And what else you are having? This is x, y, z, right? You will have x, y, z in this. Circular. Is it circular or cylindrical? Which coordinate system? Cylindrical coordinate system. And you might be having spherical coordinate system. Why you need to have these three coordinate systems? Why can't you do everything with this one? See, all are equivalent to each other. Then why you need to study three coordinate systems? You can always try with rectangular, or you can always try with cylindrical, or you can always try with spherical coordinate systems. The reason is once again same thing. That's something similar to this one. Some operations might be easy in rectangular coordinate system. Some operations, some mathematical operations might be easy in polar coordinate system. Similarly, some of the operations might be easy in this domain. Some of them might be easy in cylindrical coordinate system. Some operations might be easy in spherical coordinate system. It depends on application to application. Wherever that is suitable, you need to fit that one. See, you can solve the problems related to cylindrical and spherical coordinate systems with the help of rectangular. But the amount of effort you need to do is very high. In order to reduce that effort, you are going for cylindrical or spherical. You can get the solution with this also, but you may need to give lot of effort in order to have your final answer. Just for mathematical simplicity, you are trying to approach for different coordinate systems. You can call it like a transform, right? You are trying to transform this coordinate system into cylindrical system. You are trying to transform rectangular system into spherical system. Like that, you can think. That means if you feel like the computations might be easy in transform domain, then you can apply some transform on top of that one. But some of the operations might be easy in that actual domain itself. For example, yeah, can you just tell me some examples on this one? Some operations might be easy in time domain. Some operations might be easy in frequency domain. Yeah.
Multiplication, sir.
Okay, multiplications will be easy in time domain. You need to go for convolution, right?
Convolution, yes, sir.
Yeah, some of the operations might be easy in time domain as compared to frequency domain. It depends on application, right? You want to solve your problem in a few steps. You can approach time domain or you can approach that frequency domain method. But that depends on that application, right? Application to application, that will vary. Some applications might be done easily in time domain. Some of them might be solved easily in frequency domain or the transformer domain. It depends on situation. But you can solve that problem using any method. It may take more time if you approach some wrong method. But finally, you may get answer. There is no doubt at all. In order to reduce that effort, you are going for transforms. This is one example. Why we need transforms. Here also, we are trying to reduce the effort, right? Instead of doing this convolution, you can simply apply this intuition, right? Multiplication in the frequency domain, gain multiplied, and phase will be added to this one. And you can get the final answer straight away. That's the benefit of transforms in this case. Okay, I'll try to ask one more question. Yeah. Let me consider this one. This is RC low pass filter, first order low pass filter. Let me consider this one as input. X of t is my input and y of t is output of this LTA system. The impulse response for this LTA system is 1 by RC e power minus t by RC into u of t. U of t means, yeah, what is u of t?
Unit step function.
Yes, unit step function, right? This is equal to 0 for t less than 0. Otherwise, that is equals to 1, right? inst of response. Inst of function. It's an impulse response of the system. And it's a transfer function, right? If you apply Fourier transform for this one, in the frequency domain, you are going to get H of F. That is 1/1 J2 pi f RC. Yeah, can someone answer what is magnitude of this one and what is phase of this? I want to know what is magnitude and phase of that one. I have my H of F as follows: 1/1 J2 pi f × RC. Okay, before this, can you just tell me what is magnitude of this and what is phase of this? What is magnitude for this, mod of this?
Under root x square plus y square,
right? What is phase of this?
Tan inverse of y by x.
Okay, tan inverse of y by x. It's good. Then what about this? 1/x + jy. What is magnitude of this?
1/√x² + y²
Yes. Fine. Yeah. What is phase of this?
-tan inverse of y by x.
Yes. It's good. -tan inverse y by x. It's a phase of this, right? Because see, you can try to write this into r e power j theta. This can be written as r e power j theta, where r = √x² + y² θ = tan inverse y by x. Then what about 1/r e power j theta? It's simply 1/r × e power − j theta, right? And I can write like 1/r e power j × −θ. Here phase corresponds to minus theta, magnitude corresponds to 1/r. In polar coordinate, it might be comfortable for me, right? 1/r e power j theta. That's why I'm simply taking that. That's it. Minus theta means minus tan inverse y by x. Okay, then what is mod h of f in this case? Magnitude of this.
1/√1 + 2πfRC²
Okay, 2πfRC² Yeah, it's fine. Then what is the phase introduced by the system at frequency f?
-tan inverse 2πfRC.
-tan inverse 2πfRC. Yeah, it's fine. It's a phase introduced by the system to this frequency f. It's a magnitude of the system at frequency f. It's a magnitude of the system at frequency f. Now, if my input to that RC low pass filter is this one, this is my input. f1 cos 2π f1t + cos 2π f2t. Then what will be my output y of t? That's the LTA system. In the time domain, I can go for convolution, but in the frequency domain, I can apply some trick, right? If that is time domain, I need to do convolution of that x of t with this h of t. Linear convolution. It might be a bit harder for us, right? In frequency domain, I can apply some trick, right? Multiplication. I can multiply the gain and I can add phase at that frequency. Then what is the gain? Yeah, no need to have that expression fully. The gain will be this, right? Mod h of f1. Gain at f equal to f1. I simply substitute f1 in place of this. F equal to f1, right? Then that will be 1/√1 + 2πf1RC² See my gain. For example, f1 might be 1 kilohertz. F2 might be some 10 kilohertz. Replace f with 1 kilohertz. 1 kilohertz means 10^3, right? This is the gain into and some phase will be added at this frequency. What is that phase? You can tell in terms of capital H notation. What is that? This is a phase, right? This is a phase we are going to add. Angle H of F1. This is a phase. Replace F with F1. For example, F1 equals 10 power 3, 1 kilohertz in that case. Yeah, can you just tell me the second one? Then what is the response for this? Yes, we can respond.
Sir, it's modulus of h of f2 into cos 2 pi f2 t plus angle of h of f2.
Yes, it's good. Angle of h of f2. It's a response I am going to get, right? Yeah. How is it possible? I am simply adding them. See, what I am doing here is, I am considering this as an input and I am finding the response. And I am considering once again this as my input and I am finding the response. Finally, I am adding both of them. Can I do this?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Because they are eigenfunctions.
Because of this, right? It's a linear system. Linear time invariant. Just linearity is enough to do this, right? It's a linear system. If input is x1 of t, if I got output y1 of t, x2 of t input, output y2 of t. If that is linear system, it's a superposition property, right? I can simply have the output y1 of t plus y2 of t when the input is x1 of t plus x2 of t. And just applying that property for this. That's the benefit of transform, right? Yeah. Let us have a look into one more benefit. Equalization. Equalization is, for example, my actual input is x of t. And I'm passing that x of t through a channel or a medium. That medium can be copper wire, or that medium can be free space. When that is electromagnetic signal, that might be free space, right? And that can be electrical signal and passing through copper wire or whatever you want. Again, imagine some medium or some channel. Output, you got corrupted output. At the receiver, you got corrupted output. At the transmitter, you are transmitting x of t, but at the receiver, you have not received same x of t. Some corrupted output you received, y of t. Now, my target at the receiver is, I want to get back to my actual x of t. That is my target with the help of equalizer. This is equalizer system. I want to equalize the effect of this channel. Due to channel, I am getting y of t equals to x of t convolution with h of t. Now, how can I get back to my x of t? At the receiver, I want to design a system, equalize a system, h eq of t, in such a manner that this received signal is y of t, right? If I do linear convolution with this one. See, if this is impulse response of my system, and when this is an LTA system, then I can simply call this as my output, right? This is linear convolution. This is the input of this LTA system. Y of t, linear convolution with h eq of t. Actually, I am expecting this one. If I do linear convolution with this one, I should get this one. That's what my target. Can I call it like inverse system? Is it okay? Inverse system. Okay, do you agree this? Have you heard this term in signals and systems course, inverse system? Okay, yeah, that's fine. Inverse system means H of t convolution with H I of t should be equal to delta of t. For example, if you want to have clarity over this, this y of t is nothing but my actual transmitted signal convolution with h of t. This is due to channel effects. I am expecting this whole thing should be equal to x of t. I can apply associative property of convolution, right? X of t convolution with h of t convolution with h eq of t is same as x of t convolution with this. If this part is equals to delta of t, then what is x of t convolution with delta of t? Yes, can you answer? What is x of t convolution with delta of t?
X of t, sir.
X of t, right? What is x of t convolution with delta of t minus 2?
X of t
minus 2. Minus 2.
Yeah, that's fine. That's what my target, right? I need to design an equalizer system at my receiver in such a manner that I'll get back to my actual transmitted signal. I want to nullify the effect of this channel or medium. It means this is our target, right? This is equalizer. My target is as follows. This is my target, and I need to find this system. I know what is my channel effects. That h of t impulse response of the channel, and I want to design a system in such a manner that I will satisfy this condition. It's a linear convolution. Do you think this is easy in time domain? For example, I'll try to give some h of t to you as follows. Some h of t equals to 1 by RC, e power minus t by RC. Consider LDR system only. Then what will be my HEQ of t? Forget about frequency domain. Think everything in the time domain. Let's assume that you don't know what is frequency domain also. Then is it possible to guess what is your HEQ of t? I want HEQ of t in such a manner that if I do convolution of this one with this, I should get delta of t. This deconvolution is not so easy, right? It's very, very difficult task for you. But when coming to frequency domain, yeah, can someone tell me how to proceed this in the frequency domain? In time domain, that's very difficult for me. That's why I left that one. Yeah, can someone suggest me how to do this in frequency domain? How to design
H of S into H equivalent of S equals to 1, sir. Applying the Laplace transform.
Yes. Or you can apply Fourier transform. That's fine. Forget about constant factor. No need to worry about 2 pi or such things. I'm just bothering you about that intuition behind that. Yeah, that's fine. Then my H equalizer of F equals to 1 by H of F. Or as you said, you can go in Laplace domain also. That's also fine. In the Laplace domain, you can do. Yes. Yeah, I had a doubt. Why you need to study these two transforms? Laplace transform and Fourier transform. why you need to study Laplace transform when you already know Fourier transform. Yeah, what the purpose of this? Is it okay? S equal to j omega. Laplace transform to Fourier transform. Is it okay? Are any mistake in this? Yeah, do you agree this? If I have Laplace transform with me, some h of s, and I want to know Fourier transform for this one, can I simply do this? Are any mistake? S equal to j omega.
We have sigma plus j omega. No?
Sigma plus j omega, that's fine. I'll take sigma equal to 0. Yes, yeah, one of you can just tell me the expression for h of s, inverse of h of t. Can you fill this gap? Is it true? I don't naturally, you need to answer. Is it true? See, is it okay or any mistake is there in this? Is it Laplace transform?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That 1 by 2 pi, if you have, it's fine. No need to worry about the constant factors. Let me think briefly. Yeah. I want to know frequency domain for a transform of this one. H of t, e power minus j omega t d t. Is it true? Yeah, then can I substitute s equal to j omega?
Yes, sir.
Yes, now you need to answer. I already know what is my Fourier transform. Then what is the purpose of studying Laplace transform?
Sir, for some signals, Fourier transform does not exist, sir. In that case, we can find it using Laplace transform.
Yes, it's good. What are such systems? Can you just name those systems?
Neither energy nor power signals.
Yeah. It means they are unstable systems. When the system is unstable, see, when Fourier transform will exist?
If it is stable, I mean, absolutely when, integrable.
Yes, when that is absolutely integrable means when that is stable system, then Fourier transform will exist. When that is unstable system, Fourier transform won't exist, right? In order to analyze unstable systems, we are going for Laplace transform. You can't analyze the system with the help of Fourier transform. Such systems, unstable systems. That's the benefit of this one. Yeah, such things you might face in control systems course. Okay, do you have control systems course this semester? Is it already done or this semester we are
already
done?
Done, sir, in last semester.
Okay, yeah, control systems you might be using Laplace transform everywhere, right?
Yes, sir.
Laplace transform, even you can analyze unstable systems. It's a benefit of going to Laplace transform. See, both of them are doing more or less same thing. Just s equal to j omega. When there is stable system. If there is stable system, I can simply replace s with j omega to get my Fourier transform. When that is unstable, I can't simply do that then. Because sigma equal to 0 won't be part of ROC when that is unstable system. Yes. Let's assume that everything is fine and my system is stable system. Then I can go ahead with Fourier transform, right? If that is unstable, then I'll go with Laplace transform. Yeah, by default, I am assuming that there is stable system. And I can go with this expression. It's a bit easy, right? And you might study something in network synthesis. Have you heard this term, network synthesis, in BEE course or somewhere else? Network synthesis means if you have some H of S with you, or some H of omega, that ratio of two polynomials, then you can try to generate a circuit with the help of that one, that RLC component circuit. Yeah, in that way you can try to generate the circuit. It's very good for you, right? Your transforms are very helpful in order to find that inverse system also. That's the benefit of transforms, right? And what else we have discussed in our yesterday session? Yeah, why digital? This you might have discussed, right? We just compared DEC lab with network theory lab. Which one is, yeah, in which case we are going to get accurate output?
DEC, sir.
Yeah, DEC, right? We already discussed in our yesterday session. Accurate output as compared to this one. The reason behind this one is it's a digital in nature. This can take either logic 0 or logic 1. For example, logic 0 might be minus 5 volts, logic 1 might be plus 5 volts. Suppose if I got 4.1 volt as my output, I can simply round up to nearest one. The nearest one is 5, right? I'll call it like logic 1. Suppose if I got minus 3.7, then I'll try to call it like bit 0 only. Because that is nearby minus 5, right? I have only two possible output voltage levels in digital. I am making it like a benefit, right? Even some noise added to this one. Due to noise, you might get minus 3.7, for example. Still, I can decode this like bit 0. Here, minus 0.9 noise added to this signal and I got 4.1. Still I can decode this like logic 1. Because I have only two possible levels, right? I'm simply going for thresholding operation. My voltage is above 0, I'm calling it like logic 1. Below 0, I'm calling it like logic 0. That's the benefit we are going to get with the digital. It's having high noise immunity, right? Okay, do you agree this one or any mistake? Noise immunity. What is the meaning of noise immunity? Yeah, for example, I say COVID-19 is there, right? If you are immune system is good, implies almost no effect, right? If your immune system is bad, some bad effect on you, right? Then what about this one? Can you relate this one to this? Do you agree this statement? Noise immunity is high in digital.
Yes, sir.
It's more immune to noise, right? If some noise added, for example, in this scenario, minus 0.9 added to this one, you got 4.1. But your immunity is high, so that you are able to get back to your actual one, bit one, logic one. It's noise immunity is high in digital. One of the benefits you are going to get with digital. Yeah, what else? The benefits you are going to get with digital. When compared to analog. Okay, in your mobile phone, are you storing the data in digital form or analog form?
Digital, sir.
Digital, right? In the form of ones and zeros only, right? Digital storage is easy for you, right? Yes, what else is the benefit with the digital? For example, if you consider that analog photography is there, right? You might be going for film kind of thing. That negative kind of thing you might hard, right? When coming to digital, there is just memory cells in that hard disk or somewhere else, right? That size required also very less for the storage purpose. Do you agree this one? Encryption is easy in digital. Encryption means security. See, for example, let me consider my data in this one. This is my data, digital data, actual data. And I'm trying to do encryption with this. Yeah, just for basic understanding, I'm explaining with some small example. Encryption code, for example, let's assume like this. Let me have this. Let me call this like my encryption code. And I know what is my encryption code. I know this encryption code at my receiver only. Others don't know what is my encryption code, but I know what is the kind of encryption code I am using. This I am storing somewhere in my phone memory or somewhere else. While transmitting data from someone, see, some of your friend wants to transmit the data with the help of this encryption code. He also knows what is your encryption code. That person knows your encryption code and you know what is your encryption code. None of the others knows about your encryption code. Only two of you knows what is this code. What he is doing is, he is not willing to transmit this data directly through air. See, wireless communication, when coming to cellular mobile communication, everything is transmitted through medium, right? Free space. Your mobile phones to cell tower, that is wireless communication, right? There is a chance that some others might tap that signal, right? Some others might grab that signal and they can get the information from that, right? In order to avoid that one, you can go for encryption kind of thing. Suppose this code is known only for your friend and for you. None of the others don't know this encryption code. Then there's no issues with this one. One of the ways to do encryption is you can simply do XOR operation of this and this. Yeah, what is the XOR operation of these two things? You see, XOR operation. Can you just tell me XOR operation between this and this? One XOR with one.
Zero, sir.
Next.
One.
One. Next.
One.
One. Next.
One.
One.
zero
Zero.
zero one
Zero.
zero one
One
zero
zero. Right? See, this is different from your actual data, right? Actual data is this one. But what your friend is doing is, he trying to transmit this data instead of this data. You're trying to transmit this data instead of transmitting this data then you are going to receive this data. If some others wants to tap this data, then they can get this information. They won't get this information straight away. This is some wrong information, right? How can you decode this? Is it okay if I do XOR operation once again with this one? I know what is my encryption code. If I repeat this process once again, then what is 10 XOR?
One.
XOR with this and this at the receiver.
One
is 0 and 01 is 1 and next 01 is 1 next 10 is 1 00 is 0 11 is 0 10 is 1. Is it same as my actual data? Same, right? This is same as my actual data. That's the benefit of digital, right? See, indirectly what I am doing is, I am doing XOR of all the three things. No, what I am doing, XOR of data with encryption code, followed by once again encryption code. Then what is the XOR of this one with same thing? Indirectly, that's what I am doing. XOR of this with this one, followed by once again this one. And I can apply associative principle. Then what is the XOR of this one with this itself? What is X XOR with X?
Zero, sir.
Zero, right? Now all of them will become zeros and zero XOR with data is same as data only. Indirectly, that's what I am doing, right? Yeah, encryption might be easy for me, right? Yes, yeah, some of the benefits we are going to get with digital systems. And let's have a look into some other benefits. Let's go for some simulation, basic simulation. I want to generate music signal with the help of a program. With the help of a program, I want to generate a music signal. That's what my plan. See, I don't have a microphone with me. I'm not playing with the help of a microphone. I have speakers with me and I have a system with me. And I have a program in order to generate some music signal, random music signal. It's a program. With the help of this program, I want to generate some tones, some frequency components, and I want to play those frequency components with the help of this inbuilt speaker. Let me try to play this one. Yes, one of you can answer. Okay. We are not using any music instrument at all, right, in this one. What we are doing is, we are trying to generate sinusoidal signals with different frequencies. In digital only. Whatever I am doing, that's through a program or through some code, right? Something similar to your C programming. More or less similar to that C programming only, using this MATLAB, we are trying to write that mathematical expression for tones, mathematical expression for the tones. And after that one, we are trying to pass that one through speakers. That's what we are doing. That means for this process, I require some memory to write my program. To write my code, I require some memory, right? Yeah, what else I require? Can you just list out that one? In order to generate this music signal, what are the components that you require? I need some memory to write my program or to write my code. And what else I require? Is it enough? Memory is enough? See, suppose I want to generate this signal, cost 2 pi, 1 kilo signal, 10 power 3 t. I want to generate this signal t equal to 0 to 1 second, for example. I want to generate this signal. I'd like to sample this signal and I'd like to generate samples of this 1 kilo signal. Yeah, we'll let you discuss that later. Suppose if I fix t equals 0.1, I need to compute this, right? Cos 2 pi 10 power 3 into 0.1. I need to generate this sample with the help of my system. Do you think memory will take care of this one, or you need processor? Which one will compute this one? Which one is responsible to compute cos theta? This is some theta, where theta equals to 2 pi 10 power 3 into 0.1. Yeah, you can answer. Which one is responsible to compute this expression? Is it memory? Processor, right? You require some processor in order to do these mathematical computations. We need memory, we need processor. And in our scenario, we have a speaker with us. Inbuilt speaker is there in this system. Okay. Are you able to listen to that sound? Yeah, one of you can answer. Are you able to listen to that sound earlier? Okay, that's audible only, right? For you, earlier sound. We need this setup, right? That's what we are doing with the help of digital. That means, see, when coming to analog, how can you generate single sinusoidal signal? How to generate? You forget about this digital. When coming to analog, how to generate? You need to go for oscillators, right? You need to go for positive feedback oscillators. That transistor with some positive feedback setup will be there, right? It's very hard to get the output, right? When coming to digital, that is very easy. That means you can try to generate some signals with the help of digital, right? Just you need memory, processor, followed by some extra interface in order to convert that to analog system. Yeah, it's already 1 hour, right? Okay, do you have any doubts? You can ask me. Yeah, no problem. You can interact. I'm expecting more interaction from you.